Shalom Chavarim, I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live, and what we're seeing today on RT News is a couple of different stories that we've been looking at here this morning just to kind of highlight the events that are going on in the Middle East there. In Syria, as of right now, the RT did a special report speaking about the safe zones inside of Aleppo and those zones that are not safe. And one of the things that they pointed out in this particular video that you're going to see here on your screen here in just a moment. In fact, let me go ahead and blow it up big enough for you to be able to see it a little better there. Is that RT's crew was there inside Aleppo on the government-held side where it is safer to move about, but right there next to what they call the no man's land, about 100 meters of area there, the cameraman will actually take the camera and point it through the hole there in this section of land where you don't cross unless you take a risk of being shot and killed. But what was interesting is that they're going to show you two different types of flags that are flying there. One flag is the Al-Nursa flag, which looks very much like the ISIS flag. It's a black flag, but it's for the Al-Nursa group there. But also flying in the, looking out the same window is the ISIS flag as well, showing part of what we reported yesterday, that the groups are merging together. Al-Nursa also that it merged with, as we already know, the moderate-backed U.S. rebels. They have officially announced their merger together. So now with Al-Nursa, ISIS fighting together, and they're merging with the U.S.-backed moderate rebels. What is Russia to do now? I guess the United States would expect them to bomb absolutely nobody while they go ahead and topple Bashar al-Assad. The sheets are showing also on your screen. They have to put these up because if they don't have sheets up on the building and on windows, then the snipers of these different groups, Al-Nursa, Al-Qaeda, the moderate rebels, etc., they're targeting anybody and everybody. In fact, the guy here, while he's trying to do the interview, he keeps having to stop because of the gunfire outside the room there. It's just a very bad situation there. And children are just really at a high risk in this area. They actually interviewed several people in the process there. And in every case there, the different people that they interviewed speak about how that they are that their families try to leave from the other side, but of course they're being shot and killed. This is something that people like the journalist Vanessa Bealey has pointed out as well, is that the people are wanting to get to the government-held side, whereas the mainstream media always tries to point it out that it's the other way around, that it's just Russia killing all the civilians there. But in fact, according to some of the people they interview, like this guy right here, listen to it. Sorry about that.
Choose the streets. We can't even send kids to school.
I'm only scared of shells. They destroyed a house there, but we hid in the basement.
They're going to talk about civilians being targeted.
Much like this one. Not exactly easy to navigate, but to a degree, safe and better than the alternative. Look at this street. Do you see anything strange? Like the kids and everybody sticking to the right. Nobody goes in the middle of the street because they know there's a rebel sniper on the other end. If this isn't the definition of living in terror, then I don't know what is.
No, not just the army. He shoots at civilians too. He shoots at anyone who tries to get water from that well.
Hundreds of thousands of people now, in Western Aleppo.
It's a good point that she brought out there. She said that they shoot at anybody, the sniper she's talking about. She said not only the soldiers, but anyone that are trying to get water from the well, these snipers will shoot at. Civilians as well, children, makes no difference. And then they try to blame that Russia cuts off the water to the people, to the citizens of Syria or of Aleppo. But it's not the case. It's actually... it is the U.S.-backed rebels and all of their little cohorts there that are in the operating in that area. Another article interesting here, in fact, also on Facebook, a friend there sent me the same article as well. Antoinette did. Thank you, sister. But I'd actually seen this article myself already a little bit earlier ago. That's why we wanted to come in and do a briefing here. The British are being outfitted in chemical weapons suits on an attack that they're planning to do alongside with the Kurds of Mosul, which is in Iraq. It speaks about that the United States had actually come under mustard gas attacks while trying to fight in this area of Iraq. But the article also goes into how the British people, if they knew that they have boots on the ground in Iraq, it doesn't go over very well with the population over there. But they are preparing for a launch to free Mosul from ISIS-held stronghold in that part of the region of the world. And again, as we've stated before, that often reminds us of the prophetic side of the book of Nahum that speaks of Nineveh becoming a ruinous heap, and that the people will flee from there, and that the refugees of Nineveh, which, by the way, Nineveh is modern-day Mosul in Iraq there, that they become refugees. It speaks about the plundering of it, the pillaging, the stealing of the antiquities and selling them. And everything that's happened was written by the prophet Nahum. I'm Stephen Bannon. Just a quick take of our broadcast today. Blessings to all of you, and we'll be speaking later.